Hello, everyone. It's all so good to be here with you this morning. As you're walking in, go ahead and make your way forward. We're going to read scripture together. It'll be up. You can read along if you want or just follow along. Would you please stand to your feet before we start singing? We'll read this scripture from Psalm 63. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. Let's praise him this morning. He is worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. And lead me in your love. Jesus, we could proclaim your holiness this morning, and you're worthy of all our praise. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can take a seat.
Good morning. Welcome to the Bridge Church. My name is Sarah, and our mission here at the Bridge is to help people connect with God and develop them into fully devoted followers of Christ. So whether you're joining us in person or virtually, we're glad that you have chosen to join us this weekend. And we also want to extend a special welcome to those of you joining us for the first time. So thanks for coming and joining with us. I'd like to invite you to pull out the announcement insert on the inside of your program. So this is going to have everything that you're going to need to know about upcoming events and happenings at the Bridge. Feel free to look over this at your own convenience. I am going to highlight just a few things for you here this morning. So today, fall growth group signups are beginning, and you're going to hear more about that later on in the service, so look forward to that. Also, the 4:12 student ministry is kicking off this Wednesday from 6 to 9 p.m. here at the church building, and that's for middle and high school students. And we would love for any students ages 6th grade through senior in high school to come and check that out. Next is, next Sunday, we are going to have our church building dedication, Dedication Sunday, and we're really excited about this. It's Sunday, September 11th at 10 a.m., so normal church time. The Bridge will experience a historic occasion. Please plan to celebrate with us, followed by an all-church potluck. Please bring a dish or two to share, and paper and plasticware will be provided. And we would love anyone who calls the Bridge Church their home to come and attend the service and the potluck afterwards to just celebrate what God has done to get us to this place. And then lastly, I'd love for you to pull out the communication card on the inside of your program. You could also scan the QR code on the front of your program. If you have been attending the Bridge for a while, please feel free to just write your name and any updated contact information. If you are newer to the Bridge, or if this is your first time, we would love for you to fill out any information that you feel comfortable sharing. And then you're going to place it in the pocket and the seat back in front of you when you are finished. So let's just take a minute now together to fill those out. And the date is September 4th. Before we continue on with our service, I would love for you guys to stand and join me as I pray. Jesus, we thank you for just the many ways that you are moving here at the Bridge. God, we thank you for the opportunity together to grow in our walks with you and to be challenged through the growth groups that will be announced later in the service, Lord. God, we thank you for the 4:12 ministry that allows middle and high school students to gather with people who love you and who can help walk through challenging things. Lord, and we give you praise for this new building that you have provided, and we're looking forward to celebrating next weekend. And God, we lift up Jerry as he gives the message today. Lord, I pray that your spirit would guide Jerry's words, that he would be sensitive to your leading this morning. Lord, I pray for open hearts for those of us listening, that we would be encouraged and challenged as we wish as we worship through song and through Jerry's message. So we thank you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to continue worshiping together. We are called to lift our voices and worship the Lord. And again, that Psalm 63, God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you, my soul thirsts for you. Let's proclaim this morning, he is our God, and he's worthy of our praise. And this song is, he's our anchor of hope. wonderful, infinite God, author of all that is good, faithful provider and giver of life, source of all power and merciful God, radiant, holy, divine, beautiful Father, victorious Son, source of unchangeable life. Constant, unwavering God, Shepherd who comes for the lost, Rock of salvation, remarkable love, Savior who died on the cross, and great. So
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
God, we just thank you for that love, that you are truth, and you give us so much grace daily, Lord. And I just pray that we would earnestly seek your face, and that we would come to realize just how incredible of a sacrifice you gave for us, for me, for everyone here, Lord. And we just are ruined when we think about that sacrifice, and it's just so amazing and glorious, and we don't deserve it, but you give it freely. And we just pray this morning that you would be glorified by our thoughts to you and our posture to you this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You can be seated.
Good morning. My name is Karen Condit, and I would like to invite all women of the Bridge to a prayer tea on Saturday, September 17th, from 10 to 11:30. We had our first tea in June, and we've been at since then. When's the next tea? So it's time. This is the next tea, and we are really excited. In fact, there's a surprise that I don't even know about that I was told about this morning. So it's going to be a great time. It's going to be a relaxed time to get to know other women. We're going to listen to a short 12-minute prayer, teaching on prayer by Elizabeth Elliott, through a podcast, and then there'll be a time set aside just for some quiet reflection and for you to have some time conversing with Jesus. You will not need to pray out loud. You will not need to tell us how much you pray, how little you pray, how to pray. Of course, all that doesn't really matter. What matters is that we are called to pray. Romans 12 says, "Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer." So that's why we do this, to encourage one another to pray. Martin Luther said, "To be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing." So in other words, prayer is our spiritual breath, and we may be able to hold our breath for a little while, right? We can hold it for a certain amount of time, physically as well as spiritually, but without it, I think we'd all agree that we would not last long. So it is with prayer. Without it, our relationship with Jesus would die. So I hope you'll come for tea on September 17th. You'll meet new friends. You'll be encouraged in your prayer life. You'll have some personal time to be quiet and reflect and pray and converse with Jesus. And if you have a friend that might be interested, please feel free to invite them. Sign up begins today after the service. To be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing. Thank you.
I'm Sue Kellen, and I'm the director of growth groups at the Bridge. And this is Lane Jordy, and she's the intern for growth groups. And it's really been fun to work together to prepare for our fall growth groups that are starting in 2 weeks. So as many of you know, the mission at the Bridge, it's already been mentioned, is to help people connect with God and develop them into fully devoted followers of Jesus. And how we do that at the Bridge, one of the major things we do is have semester-based elective growth groups. Small groups, and we call them growth groups because we want to provide a place where you can grow spiritually, vertically with God, but also you can grow horizontally, make friends, have relationships that are based on prayer and the Bible within the church family. And these groups also provide a way for you to be involved in a small group doing an outreach for our community, which probably many of us wouldn't think to do if we weren't in a small group. So we are excited about growth groups starting in 2 weeks, and we want to tell you more about them.
So if you will take out your growth groups at the Bridge insert and follow along, and you can look, there's slides next to us as well that's going to have pictures of each of the leaders as well as some information. So we're not going to take 20 minutes to read through the entirety of this insert, so please follow along. As you mentioned, growth groups start in 2 weeks on September 18th. The groups begin then, but sign-ups begin right now. So you can sign up on the back of your communication card that you already put your name on, because Sarah encouraged all of us to do that. So your name is already on it, and now you can sign up on the back. So that is one way you can sign up. You can sign up in the lobby with Sue or I. We will be at the table after the service, or you can sign up on the website. An important thing to point out is that childcare reimbursements are available if that matters for you, and if you have children, that is an option. All right, let's go through the groups. On Sunday, we have three groups. On our first group on Sunday afternoon is Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life. Join Kyle and Deborah and Grant and Fern for lunch, as well as a time to go through one of my favorite topics, which is spiritual disciplines, and this one is by Donald Whitney. Second, we have Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University on Sunday evening with Cameron Bump and Jacob Orff. And this is a great course for learning how to live generously with your finances while beating debt and planning for the future. And finally, on Sundays, Welcome to the Family with Jerry and Sue Kellen is a great group to learn more about the Bridge, meet others, and have the chance to become a voting member at the end of the group.
On Monday evenings, we have two groups happening. The first one is Christ-Centered Parenting by Russell Moore. It's facilitated by Adam and Alicia Condit. Parents, this group will help equip you to discuss some of the most challenging topics our kids are facing today from a gospel perspective. We also have a men's group. Join Bob and Jens to read and discuss Gospel Wakefulness by Jared Wilson. Men, you will learn what it looks like to fully experience the power of the gospel in your life.
And Tuesday morning, we have an awesome book by Julie Slattery called Finding the Hero in Your Husband. This will be led by Kelly Witschke and Kim Bump. And this will be a cool time to learn and be challenged how to see our husbands in a new light. On Tuesday, we have, this is in the evening, Jesus Through the Eyes of Women, led by Sue and Brianna, and join them for a time to connect with other women and learn how women viewed Jesus when he was walking on the earth. And lastly, on Tuesdays, join the Kepins and the Carlsons as they go through Sent, living a life that invites others to Jesus. Be encouraged and learn practical strategies to involve those that are already around you.
Let's move on to Wednesday. Wednesday morning, very early, at Cabin Coffee, women will be joining with Jamie and Krista for a women's group that will be reading and discussing Jesus Through the Eyes of Women by Rebecca McLaughlin. Later that morning, our women's prayer group meets, and they meet every other Wednesday at 10 a.m. and join other women for a time of prayer, reflection, and intercession.
And Thursdays, we have our mom's group on Thursday mornings here at the Bridge. Join Renee, Rachel, and Brianna for some kid-free mom time and take some intentional time to learn and grow in motherhood. Thursday evening, we have join Luke and I and Andrew and Molly as we go through a Bible project course called Introduction to the Hebrew Bible. This will be a time to learn from Tim Mackey and develop new and exciting skills for reading the Old Testament.
Finally, on Friday, we end the week with an early morning men's prayer group that will meet here in the building, and Pastor Jerry and Grant Eiley will be leading that. And men, you're encouraged to join this group on Fridays to recalibrate your hearts through scripture and prayer.
So those are our 13 options for the semester. We're excited to get that going. So please take a second to sign up. See us in the lobby if you have any questions, and just be prepared and excited for a semester of spiritual and relational growth. Thanks.
So thanks for being at gathering with us as a church body this morning. Now we're gonna dismiss Bridge Kids in a minute, but just kind of be patient for another couple minutes. So because you're here, think about this. There's a 29% reduced risk of depression for attending church regularly. Okay, there's a 33% reduced risk of death. Now, we're all going to die unless Jesus comes back, but you're in a different category. 33% reduced risk of adolescent illegal drug use for families who attend church regularly. 50% reduced risk of divorce for families who attend church regularly. 84% reduced risk of suicide for families who attend church regularly. Now, I check the stats every once in a while because there's always some kind of information about attending church, and those aren't like the most important reasons. There are some interesting ones. Those are 2021, so they're pretty current. That's about as current as you can get for statistics, by the way. Now, can you just be patient for a couple more minutes, Bridge Kids? I have a story that I want to start with, and I think some of our kids would really benefit from it. I know that some of them, it'll just, when is he done? I know. So listen to this. George Roy Wood and Elizabeth Rhodes went to China as missionaries in 1949, and they went to plant a church. 17 years later, they were forced to leave the country because of the communist takeover in China. At that time, the church was about 200 people, which is a pretty significant church for a church in China. So they had to leave the country, and Elizabeth died in 1979, and George died in 1984, and they never had heard what had happened to the church. During that time, all those years, the communist government sought to destroy the church. The church had been turned over to a local pastor named Pastor Meng, and he was not permitted to preach. They were not permitted to hold worship services on Sunday morning. In fact, during that time, he was imprisoned for 9 years for propagating the gospel. In 1988, George and Elizabeth's son, also named George, decided to return to China and inquire what had happened to the church, because he'd been a small boy during those days with his parents. And what he learned was a big surprise. He met with Pastor Meng and asked, how is the church doing today? And he wasn't expecting much. And they brought out to him the current church roster, and it was page one, page two, page after page after page, and then now there had been over 1,500 baptized, committed followers of Jesus in their church, 1988. And so George asked, how did this happen? And Pastor Meng said, we pray a lot. That's it. We pray a lot. And he said, Jesus is the same yesterday and today and forever. We can trust him. Now, Pastor Meng died in 2006 at the age of 96. At that time, there was over 15,000 baptized followers of Christ committed to that church. No slick programs. The power of God and the prayer of believers. God can do amazing things in his church. I wanted our kids to hear that. Okay, Bridge kids, you may just casually slip out. Thank you for joining us. So today I want to talk about what I should know about the church. What I should know about the church. So please notice the screens. I'll just use this. Thank you. So this, I hope this is the last time you see the screens. I hope. We have a good plan in place. I'm hoping next week we're going to have new screens, and those will be in some other part of the building. So we're working on that. It's getting really close, okay? First thing I want to point out is the church was God's idea. It's not man's idea. It's not a denomination's plan. This whole thing called the church, what we know as the church, is God's idea. It was God's idea from the very beginning. In fact, before creation, according to Ephesians chapter 1. But it was Jesus who first spoke of it by name. And it came from his promise. Jesus gave a promise to his disciples. And we find that in Matthew 16, verses 15 through 18. And so Jesus has this question. He says, but what about you? Who do you say I am? So he's asking his disciples, guys, you've hung around me for a while. He's wanting to know, what do you think about the things that I've told you? Who do you think I am? Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Peter got that one right. Now, he messed up a few times with Jesus and was kind of embarrassing, but this one, it was right on the money. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for it was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, not by humans, but by my Father in heaven. Peter is spiritually connected and tracking with God. Verse 18, and he says, and I tell you that you are Peter. On this rock I will build my church. So, interesting, in the original language, which would be Greek, that you are Peter, and that is Petros, and that's a masculine word in Greek, and it means rock. And so he's saying, on you, Peter, you who are the rock, on this rock, but he changes the word from Petros to Petra, which is neuter, and it's not Peter. It's something else. And the question is, well, what was the rock? Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. So what's the rock? Well, it was not a person. It was not Peter. It was not the Pope. It is the commitment of Peter. It is the confession of Peter. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. It's who Jesus is and why he has come. That's the confession. That's the rock. And Jesus said, on that, I'm going to build my church. The key phrase is, I will build my church, said Jesus. He said he would do it. He says, I will do it. It's a promise of Jesus' future plan, Jesus' work, Jesus' desire. It's his plan. He's gonna provide the resources. He says, I will. And then he says, build my church. Now, maybe to some people's surprise, it was never meant as a physical building. It's not a physical structure that Jesus was talking about. He's talking about the church. He's using a building as a metaphor. He's going to be building his church. And the word is ekklesia, and it means called out ones. has nothing to do with the building, has never intended to have anything to do with the building. And by the way, I just hope when we talk about where our building is, that we just say the church building rather than the church, so that we'll just keep that clear. The church is a called out group. It's an assembly of believers in a local place. He says, I will build my church. It's his church, Jesus said. His church, not my church. Not, we can say it's our church, but he's the one who is the possessor. He purchased us. He redeemed us with his life, with his blood. And we are his. It's his church. That's a great comfort to me. It's his idea. It's his plan. He's doing it. He will do it. I just need to join in the plan that he has. And then there's his promise. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. The power of spiritual darkness will not overtake his church. The power of Satan and his demons will not prevail against it. Jesus wins the spiritual war. It doesn't mean we're not going to have struggles. It doesn't mean we're not going to experience loss. But the bottom line is, Jesus has the ultimate victory, and the church has the ultimate victory standing with Jesus. Okay, secondly here, it started in Acts chapter 2. The church got its start in Acts chapter 2. Sometimes I use the word church plant. I always mean a start for a church startup. Sometimes church plant seems strange to people. It's the idea of putting something in a place and then growth happens. And part of that comes from the church as an organism. Think about that. The church got its start in Acts 2, and let's build on that. So let me just give a little context here to Acts chapter 2. What's happened in Acts chapter 2 so far? So you have to think in terms of, sometimes we forget when we start reading like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's the story of Jesus, the Gospels. We forget that those people were under the Old Testament, under the authority of the Old Testament Scripture. And Jesus' appearance was a time of transition. The new had not come yet. It was the appearance of Jesus, and he said, behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. And so there's a transition happening. The king is present. The kingdom is coming. The kingdom is present with Jesus, but not until his death is it inaugurated. And now the church is ready to be birthed. So in Acts chapter 2, Jesus had lived by then. He had died and been crucified by then. He had been resurrected by then. And in Acts chapter 1, he ascended into heaven. And he sat down at the right hand of God. And he is alive right now, directing his church, by the way. So prayer does really matter. He is alive. So Jesus ascended into heaven. And he told his disciples, guys, I want you to go back to Jerusalem. And I want you to hang out there together, and I want you to pray. The church was birthed in prayer. From Acts chapter 1, 120 followers of Jesus gathered and prayed. And Jesus said, I'm going to be sending you someone like me. It would be the Holy Spirit. And in Acts chapter 2 is when it happens, and it's when the church gets its start. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. So Peter stands up and he's preaching, okay? And it's an amazing message because he's preaching in Jerusalem. That's where they crucified Jesus. It's pretty risky and bold to stand up where Jesus had been crucified and the disciples are a bit fearful. And then Peter preaches. He says, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus whom you crucified. And he just lays it out. Guys, you are responsible for what happened to Jesus. This Jesus is both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Next slide. Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you. He's saying, you need to turn to God. You need to come to God on His terms, not your terms, not human terms. You can't invent the terms that you want to have to be right with God. You need to come to God on His terms. You need to come to God and embrace by faith His message. And then He says, and then what you do, that's what's going to, where you're going to be saved from the penalty of your sin. And then the logical thing, and this is what they did in the New Testament, they were baptized as followers of Jesus. And, you know, we're going to have a baptism in November. But, you know, the New Testament really didn't know such a thing as a believer who had not been baptized as a follower of Christ. Okay? So just to finish that out, and Peter says, you'll receive the Holy Spirit. That will be the gift that comes to identify your salvation. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God will call. Next slide. With many other words, He warned them and pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted His message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to the number that day. That's how the church got its start. It was birthed in prayer. And if you read the story of Acts, you see the church begins to grow quickly. And with the growth of this new group of followers of Jesus came persecution right off the bat. So what happened? The church just kept growing. The church just moved out. Didn't stay in Jerusalem. They just kept expanding. And then churches got started in other towns. This all happened very quickly in the first century. So the church was God's idea. And He was the one who brought it into existence. And the bridge was God's idea. And He's the one who brought the bridge into existence. Secondly, the church is now the body of Christ. The church is now called the body of Christ. Now think about this. You know, I know I'm reminding some of you, it's a review for many of you. So Jesus died and He was resurrected and He ascended into heaven. So Jesus left, but He put His followers in charge of this new mission. And in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came, when God came on believers through the Holy Spirit, Jesus' body is now on earth through His church. He's in heaven at the right hand of God, but now Jesus is working through His body, a group of people. The church was formed and shaped by the work of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we looked at this briefly last week. So just as the body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. So what Jesus is going to, or what the Apostle Paul is saying here is, like the human body that is made up of many different parts, body parts, so it is with Christ. His body also has many different parts. And then he says, for we were all baptized by one Spirit. We talked about this last week. So as to form one body. And as I understand, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it happens to all believers. It's not just for special believers. The Corinthian church was one of the most worldly churches. In fact, maybe the most worldly or secular church in the New Testament, and all of them had been baptized by the Spirit. And simply, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is, my understanding is that God, through the Holy Spirit, takes us out of the sphere of darkness, spiritual darkness, where we are before we come to faith in Christ. And when we come to faith in Christ, He places us into the body of Christ. He immerses us, and now we identify with the body of Christ. We are in Christ. That, how we get there? We were baptized by the Holy Spirit. We are united with Christ. How did that happen? We were baptized by the Holy Spirit. The New Testament describes this union over and over and over and over in the New Testament. I'm going to jump to the next one. The church was designed by God to be a unit with many different moving parts. The church is both organic, it's a living organism, it's a spiritual body, it's alive because of God in us, but we are also an organization. We're not just an organization, but we are to be organized to do God's will. It's one of the reasons why churches need doctrinal statements and constitutions to bring some kind of organization that is recognized, that is God-honoring. So the church was designed with many moving parts. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 4 through 20. I'm not going to read the whole thing. It just talks about how even so the body is made up of one part, not one part but many. Now if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body. So he's going to go through and mention different body parts. And he's saying everyone is needed. That's the whole idea. The same is true in the body of Christ. We're going to be different. We're different people. We're unique. We have different strengths and abilities and spiritual gifts, but we're all needed. And that's the next point as well, which is just a little different wrinkle, a little different scripture. The church needs every part actively functioning. And the passage is 1 Corinthians 12, 21 through 27. And I'm not going to go through all of that one either, but you can, because just right down the line, the Apostle Paul gives us more information about the body, the spiritual body of Christ, and every part needs to be actively functioning. And he talks about how we're different. In the human body, we have some parts are on display and some parts are not on display. If you saw the body parts that aren't on display, it wouldn't be very impressive. And some parts are more on display in the body of Christ than others. His point of all of it is, you know what? There's nobody that's superior and there's nobody that's inferior. We are equal in the body of Christ. Thirdly, this is where I'd like to spend a few minutes. The church has responsibilities for every member. This, by the church, I mean God's plan for the church, has responsibilities for every member. First of all, we are to be devoted to one another. We are to be devoted to one another. Romans chapter 12, verse 10. The Apostle Paul writes, "Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves." So if you read through the New Testament, you'll find there are many, many verses that talk about our relationships in Christ. We have this spiritual union in Christ. We are part of the body, and we are in relationship. We are to be devoted to one another in love. That speaks of a high commitment. That sometimes that's hard for the American culture. It's not hard for the church in China to understand it, but it's hard for our culture because we have so many distractions and so many things we want to do. You know, all the messages we get is talk about how we need to pursue our own happiness. But devotion to one another in love is a high priority for God. This is one of the reasons why we value church membership at the Bridge. It's not that church members have a higher standing, but it's because in going through the Welcome to the Family class that we're going to start in September, it's an opportunity to find out where we stand on core doctrine, where we stand on our values, and it's sort of a way to understand the DNA, and it's a way of getting everyone on the same page. And I've been so impressed with the unity we've had at the Bridge. You know, we've walked through COVID. We walked through whether we're going to wear masks or not. We've walked through elections. We've walked through vaccines. Now, we didn't all agree on those things. There were lots of different opinions, and it's okay. Those things aren't the most important thing. It's the mission. It's why God has called us here, and we've had that unity. And I really think our Welcome to the Family class is one of those things that helps us understand what it means to be on the same page. And that's the next point. We are to be of the same attitude of mind with one another. The older translations say being of the same mind. That doesn't mean we just all agree on everything. Not going to happen. Because we are so unique, different experiences, different education, different parts of the world, different parts of the country. But we can have the same attitude of mind being like Jesus. It means a humble approach to life. It means having same values, same commitments to core beliefs. It's being on the same page about advancing the kingdom of God. Next, we're to accept one another. We are to accept one another. Romans 15:7. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God. You know, we just recognize how different we are. You're different than me. We bring so many different things in our backgrounds. You know what? It's okay. But whatever your experiences are, and whatever you've done in the body of Christ, you can be accepted. That's what we do. We accept. We're gracious about accepting people. We're all in a process. And none of us have arrived. And in the church, we accept one another. Next, we are to put up with each other's idiosyncrasies. How about that? I don't think the word idiosyncrasy is in the Bible. So I just made this up. So I've discovered that you have personality flaws. Some of you have behavior flaws. Sometimes we are hard to get along with. You know, some of us have rough edges. And that's why Scripture teaches us in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, the Apostle Paul writes, "Be completely humble and gentle." What a good approach. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. That means cutting people slack. You know, people are going to be different than us. It's okay. We don't have to pour them into our mold. It's about us being poured into Jesus' mold together. And then he says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. Whether there is an election, whether there's a pandemic, whether it's the economy, whether the government says something we disagree with, let us make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That's what we do in the body of Christ. Next, we are to encourage one another. And who doesn't need encouragement? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11. Paul writes, "Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing." Encourage. Be the cheerleader of other people around you. When somebody is serving you, say thank you. Tell them that you appreciate that. When you encourage, you know, we bring words of hope rather than words of discouragement. The next one is we are to admonish one another. This is not quite as popular as the others. So I'm sorry about that. It's kind of important, though. How many people, raise your hand if you like to be admonished. Okay, I don't always appreciate it. I learn from it. I've learned a lot when I listen to my wife, and it's very helpful. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16 says, "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another." There it is. It's in our relationships. This is one another. This isn't just, you know, pastor's sermon. This is in our relationships. When we see each other during the week, and it may be a one-on-one situation, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, assuming that we're all going to embrace that message of Christ and follow his lifestyle, the way of Jesus, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. There is a place where we teach one another. It can happen in a restaurant where you share what you know from Scripture with another believer. There is a place to admonish one another, which means sometimes we need to be reminded by another believer about the truth. Sometimes we may slip off course. Sometimes we may fall down spiritually. Sometimes we just may be disobedient. And it's appropriate for another believer to come alongside and say, "Hey, are you doing okay? What's happened here?" And just help you to be accountable. That's what it means to admonish one another, to help someone get back on course. That's why we are to speak the truth in love. Maybe it's going to be a friend. Maybe it's a spouse. Maybe it's a parent. Or maybe a child would admonish you as well. Also, we're to forgive one another. Ephesians 4:32, we are to forgive. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other. Boy, it really helps if we're kind and compassionate and forgiving each other. Just as in Christ, God forgave you. You know, some people are going to offend you. They're going to hurt you. They're going to do things that make you mad. And the Scripture says, you're called to forgive them. They don't deserve it. They don't deserve to be forgiven. But that's how Jesus wants to do it. As far as it depends on us, we are to be at peace with all people. And we're called to forgive. Well, why? Well, because as a Christ follower, Jesus forgave me. I'm a forgiven person. If I'm a forgiven person, why wouldn't I want to forgive other people so they can experience it too? Next, we are to pray for one another. Therefore, confess your sins to each other. Pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So think of an environment where not only did we forgive people, but think of, we also confess our sins. How would you like to be around people who are honest? When they fail, they say, I really blew it. I'm sorry, would you forgive me? Confessing their sins to one another. Well, yeah, I'd like to be around people like that who are honest. What about being around people who forgive you when you get off course? Jesus designed his body to be really healthy. Then we're to serve one another. Galatians 5:13. Paul writes, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free." That's really awesome. We are called by God when we place our faith in Christ. Our sins are forgiven. We're no longer condemned. We stand before God and declared righteous. And we're free from the penalty of sin. We also have been put in a place where we can overcome sin, and we are free to walk with Jesus, but we need his power. There is no condemnation. We're called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Because we do that sometimes. We use our freedom just to meet our needs. We're not going to be condemned. Jesus said, I won't be condemned. And we take our freedom too far, and we can indulge our own desires. That's gets us off course, and that's dangerous. Rather than indulging in the flesh, serve one another humbly in love. We are called to serve each other. A lot of ways to do that. Just thinking about what's going on today. We have people in Bridge Kids who are serving us. We have people in the nursery who are serving us. We have ushers and greeters today who are serving us. We have a worship team who is serving us. We have a tech team in the back that always keeps our service online and for us to have access to. We have people serving us. That's Sunday. We have other people during the week that might be leading growth groups. We have 412, people serving in 412. They're serving us. They're serving one another. But not only that, that's just within the body right now, but there's opportunities during the week where we can serve each other. We can serve people who aren't in the Bridge family because that's who we are as followers of Jesus. The last one in this section is that we are to love one another. We are to love one another. John 13, 34, and 35. This has been really powerful throughout the history of the church. Jesus said to his followers, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you who are Christ followers, you who are my disciples, must love one another. By this reputation, everyone will know you are my disciples if you love one another. This was an evangelistic strategy of Jesus. This was a tractional for the church. Love in the body of Christ. Love that's apparent. Love that it's displayed in our relationships and who we are when we relate to people inside the church and outside of the church. Jesus said, you send a message to your world of what God's like and what his church is to be like. Last point, number four, the church has one overriding mission. And we know this as Jesus is the head of the church. Colossians 1:18 says, as he is the head of the body, the church. He is Lord. He's the one in charge. He is the leader of the church. He's the brains. He's the executive director. He is sitting at the right hand of God right now, directing his church. Also, Jesus assigned every Christ follower the same mission. Every Christ follower has the very same mission. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. You've seen this many times. I expect you might see it in the future. Jesus said to his followers, after he was resurrected, before he was ascended into heaven, he says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Make disciples. That's what the mission, make disciples. How do you do that? Well, you have to share the good news so that people understand and come to faith in Jesus. We call that evangelism. And then it's about discipling or helping people grow and helping people understand the scriptures. And one of the first things for a follower of Christ is to be baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Christian baptism. Verse 20, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And there's a promise that he would be with us to the very end of the age. Teaching them to obey Lots of good stuff, right? No, it's everything. It's a total commitment to following Jesus. The way we say it at the Bridge is we want to help people connect with God and develop them into fully devoted followers of Jesus. Connecting with God is about evangelism. Helping them and developing them into fully devoted followers is teaching them to obey everything that Jesus commanded. Every once in a while, I've asked the question in the past, but it's just good to ask it every once in a while. If you were to rate yourself on full devotion to Christ today, and sometimes I've used the graph of 1 to 10, you know, if put 0 is no relationship with Christ and 10 is fully devoted follower of Jesus, where would you say you are on the scale of 1 to 10? How would you rate yourself? Are you a 10? Are you a 9? Are you a 4? Are you a 7? In your own mind. And then I always ask the question next is, okay, we're all at different places. Okay, what will it take for you to move up one? What growth steps do you need to take? And consider doing that. Very last point, you finally made it. Jesus desires that his church strive together to accomplish this mission. Philippians 1:27. The Apostle Paul says, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Whatever happens, whether it's election, whether it's a pandemic, whether it's a failure of government officials or the economy, whatever it is, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. Then Paul says, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel. Striving together. That's effort. It's hard work. It's like a picture of a runner. Think of the body of Christ as a runner, and we're all moving together into the future on mission, and we're just trying to reach the goal. And so Paul says, stand firm in one spirit. That's unity. Church is a team sport. That's good news. The mission is a team sport. I don't mean to lower it to sport, but sometimes it just helps we have a mission, and we don't have to do all of it alone. We do it together. We are better together for the faith of the gospel, for the sake of the gospel, for God's mission. It's priority one. Over 25 years ago, I heard a phrase that really grabbed my attention and really resonated with me. I heard this phrase, the church is the hope of the world. The church is the hope of the world. Now, I learned all the criticism that went with that, because, you know, right away there were Christians who wanted to say, well, you know, the church is not the hope of the world. Jesus is the hope of the world. I know that. But Jesus left his body in charge of his mission until he comes. And we are his body, and Christ is in us, the hope of glory. Serving Christ and his mission is one of the most rewarding things you will ever do with your life. It's not about going to church. It's about being the church. Jesus gave his church two ordinances, and that's how we're gonna close our time today, and we're going to celebrate communion together. Jesus gave two ordinances, that is, two instructions. We can say two laws. One is baptism, and baptism is a picture of a person's conversion, identifying with his death, burial, and resurrection. And the other one is communion, sometimes called the Lord's Supper and the Lord's Table. And what is it about? It's about the bread and the cup identifying with the body and blood of Christ, his death. His death is central to all that we are and all that we do. I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but it's Christ who lives in me. So today we're going to celebrate the good news that Jesus died for us. He died in our place. I deserve the death, and he took mine onto himself. And today we remember that. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. We tend to forget, and he wanted it to be central. And the Apostle Paul said, let a man or a woman, let a person examine themselves before they share in this time of communion, before they eat the bread or drink the cup. And so we are to let God examine us. And if we have sinned, we should confess that before him. So let's bow in prayer and let's just talk to God together. Father, I just want to come before you and give you thanks. Thank you for the privilege to be a part of your church. Thank you for Jesus who lived and died for us. And we want to acknowledge that. We want to remember that today. God, right now, as we just are here as a church gathered, may your Holy Spirit shine his light on us. And may you examine us, God. May you show us our faults, show us our sin. And may we just be honest with you and confess our sin to you privately and silently. And then, God, we're so mindful of the promise you've given us. 1 John 1:9, it never, never gets old. If we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just and will forgive us our sin and purify us of all unrighteousness. Thank you, God, that you've made a provision for us when we sin as followers of Jesus. We acknowledge we're not perfect. We're far from it. And we never want to be hypocrites. We want to be honest with you. Thank you this morning for the bread that is a symbol of your body that reminds us when we hold it. Thank you for the cup that is a symbol of your blood as we experience that and drink it together. It's a symbol. Thank you that Jesus died in our place. Amen. So our communion at the Bridge is an open communion. That simply means if you are a follower of Christ, you don't have to be a member here, but if you are a follower of Christ, you are welcome to participate. So again, we have sealed communion. That means you have to take off the little tab carefully at the top. Please be careful that you don't spill it all over you. That has happened. So take off the little top first, and there's bread. And then you take off the second top, and then there's the juice. And then, so we're going to invite you to come forward. These two aisles, you come down and grab your communion and go around back to your seat. You can take communion whenever you're ready. God bless you.
The Father turns his face away.
as wounds which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until accomplished. His dying death has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. Gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
The Apostle Paul says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We've acknowledged, we've remembered, and it's a proclamation of the gospel that Jesus died for us. Next week, building dedication, important event for the bridge. We'll just have a regular service here, and then we'll actually step outside at the end of our service and have a prayer of dedication for this building that is a tool. It is not the church. And so for the very first time, we're going to celebrate by having, this makes us a real church, we're having a potluck. So we have not done that. We have never had our own space other than being in the park for a potluck like this. So we could have catered it for you, and we decided, you know, we're just going to be a little more economical this time, and we need you to bring the food, okay? Now, I'm hoping we have some guests next week. Will you bring an adequate amount of food for you and a few extra guests as well, if that's possible? Some of you may not be able to, but that's okay. But we want to be hospitable to all who come next week. So thank you so much for being here. And at the end of our service today, we have a prayer team available for you. We invite you, if you want prayer, to come to one of our prayer leaders, and they will pray for you. God bless you all. We're dismissed.